I first, of course, want to congratulate Cecima, Ana Maria, and Marcia, and Luis, and everyone that founded and works Cecima. Well, I want to congratulate the work. For me, it's really a privilege to be here. I'm very happy, and I want to thank them for the invitation. So I'm going to talk about this first patent of the 20th century, and I'm going to read the first slide to make myself more clear. So here we go. So a little over a decade after Mexico's War of Independence came to an end, the former Pontific University was disappeared, and different schools were created. Aspo Pharmacy, the National Medical School, opened in 1833, offering both medicine and pharmacy. Through the rest of the century, institutionalized pharmacy studies were driven here. Being the main interest in the research field, the continuity and fulfillment of medicinal plants, waters, animals, and minerals having therapeutic uses, but most advanced. This was the second part of a huge project started more than a century back with the inauguration of the Royal Botanical Garden of the Nueva España, which my colleague Liliana Schifter talked to you late yesterday. So we have studied the pharmacy dissertations, this final papers that from 1867, when schools started to ask them for as a requirement to get the pharmacy degree, through 1916, when, as we saw yesterday, through 1916, when pharmacists migrated from School of Medicine to School of Chemistry. These thesis or dissertations show the questions and interests of those teachers or researchers, and we found important local global issues to be addressed. We can see at the laptop two covers of the pharmacy dissertations, and many of them were about plants, and the main interest was to analyze chemically those plants to prove all the uses that the expeditioners had found and the native people claimed. So during the government of General Porfirio Díaz, various actions were carried out to promote the country's industrialization and development of science and technology. Among the measures taken, spaces for scientific research and specialized schools were opened, such as the National Preparatory School, a big high school intended to prepare young people for graduate studies, the National School of Agriculture, and others. Mexico contributed to the study of a large number of therapeutic plants through research conducted at another quite peculiar institution, the National Medical School, NMI, opened in 1888. This NMI and the National School of Medicine were the two stilts for the continuation of local studies linking the world of native, colonial, and independent pharmacists and set the basis for a modern scientific practice. The main interest in the drug research was to find substitutes for Occidental remedies. NMI closed its doors in 1915, sadly. This interrupted the enormous nationwide project, not only local resources or local remedies, but also, and probably even more harmful, in applying science to the production of new drugs. So the knowledge in the so-called national therapeutics, namely the one based on the empirical knowledge preserved in the cold tradition, taken to a scientific level by means of chemical analysis. As for the School of Medicine, it prevailed to launch the Faculty of Medicine, still in function today, but the pharmacists left it around 1916, as I already told you, and found their own place in the National School of Chemical Sciences, and so on. So here we see, from the innovation point of view, there were two very important institutes in which pharmacy research was done. And this is a layout or a blueprint of the laboratory of the National Medical Institute. This institute reported to the Secretary of Development. This responded to the government's aim of promoting the country's capabilities and focusing on commerce and industry. Yet, the National Medical Institute researchers were more health sciences oriented. They were in charge to carry out studies on medical plants based on experimental therapeutic method, which was organized in successive stages of work corresponding to each of the sections that made up the chart of the NMI. Originally, this institute was divided into five sections: natural history, so botanical characterization, experimental physiology, they used dogs and some other minor animals, analytical chemistry, which was the core of the NMI, if I may say, experimental therapeutics in some Mexican hospitals, and medical geography and climatology. But a few years later, after its inauguration, a department of industrial chemistry was added in order to exploit products conceived and manufactured there. So this is important, the fact that the NMI had inaugurated this department of industrial chemistry, because the aims was to, okay, we've done some research here, but now we have to exploit the research and really be having some profit about all that we have done. The third section, analytical chemistry, managed to isolate active molecules of plants and sometimes achieved to quantify its components. The Department of Industrial Chemistry was in charge of developing medical preparations, which in most cases were liquid pharmaceutical presentations, such as liquids and dry extracts and tinctures, and in lesser times, papers, ointments, or pills. And so this is, we can see also Fernando Altamirano, the director of this institute from 1889 to 1908, and that's one of his drawings about the institute. So as in many other countries, the arrival of specifics for patent medicines, which were the terms used in distinctly newspapers and technical documents for naming secret formulas of broadly advertised products. So these formulas were often foreign, but sometimes made in Mexico, and in many cases were not manufactured by a company, but by a pharmacist or a small pharmacy. Mexican pharmacists did not receive gladly the idea of dispensing a product for which they could not take accountability, since they ignored its formula and preparation procedure. Let's remember that the so-called Mexican positivism was raging with a peculiar pragmatic and a very nationalistic emphasis. Mexico was willing to show the world as a lush in scientifically proven natural remedies, and was ready to complete this task and to compete with imported drugs. But that's a ministry of colonization, Department of Colonization, Industry and Commerce, which was opened April 22nd, 1853. Among its many ideas of responsibilities, it was in charge of the exploration of the land, developing exterior commerce, and attractive foreign investment. So as we said before, this was like the boss of the National Medical Institute. And in the last decades of the 19th century, there were also many changes in regards to the law. And specifically, there was a law in 1893 that gave concessions and privileges to entirely new industries in Mexico. So the legal measure granted franchises up for 20 years, with even the right to be revised later, to the companies that installed factories producing goods hitherto not manufactured in Mexico. This measure sped up the patent application to the Secretary of Development, which was the body responsible for regulating intellectual property in the country. In the field of therapeutic products, dozens of applications were submitted in the stage of the late 19th and early 20th century. So, at this point, I want to say that all of this we already knew, and in this investigation, we wanted to know what happened with those patents, who submitted those patents, and what impact, if any, those patents had. So, the aims of this study is to revise these patent applications and patents granted of medicinal products submitted to the Ministry of Development during the first quarter of the 20th century. So, during 15 out of these 25 years of the National Medical Institute, was active having the responsibility of generating intellectual property rights related to Mexican drugs. So we wanted to know if the drugs made by the IMN, National Medical Institute, had some impact in patent submissions. So this is the General Archive in Mexico, located in Mexico City. And this was the place where we looked for the patents. And so these are the preliminary findings. Yeah, first, I'm going to talk about some statistics, then some peculiarities and general findings. What we did with these patents? what we did with these patents? Well, first, localizing and selecting them. Choosing only the drugs patents, and we made some sort of classification of these patents. We first classified them by gender. We wanted to know if there were female applicants or only men applicants, and if they were female, their legal status was usually declared, so we put some attention in that. And then if the patent was provisional or definitive, the citizenship, the patent was asked for by a Mexican or a foreign, and of course the innovation of the patent, if it was a new active pharmaceutical ingredient, a new dosage form, or what happened there. So this is the number of patents that we found, 602, and this is by year of grant. So there's not a tendency. We absolutely expected to see almost no applications during Mexican Revolution, but still we see that from 1910 to 1918, we see a good activity in patent application. So we can see the impact of the revolution here. And this is the number of patents by nationality. 73% were Mexican applicants. And these are the foreign patents. We're talking about 37% Spaniards asking for a patent. Then, of course, our neighbor, the United States. And in the third place, we have Germany, and then Japan. So this is the distribution by gender, and we have, of course, many more men, but still we have happily found some women. Not all of them were widows. First, we saw that all of them were widows. Some of them are, but not everyone. And this C is for companies, some foreign companies or Mexican companies that a patent was granted for them. We also found very few, actually. This is like the main, was one of the main questions we wanted to ask, to find much more pharmacies, institutionalized pharmacies, because 19th century in Mexico was all about who is institutionalized and who isn't. There was a very, very big fight among these types of pharmacists, and we've done that work. And we thought we were going to find many institutionalized pharmacists, like since 1833 that the school was there. We thought we would find more pharmaceuticals. They're not. Still, we see some industrials there, not very well known. Francisco Bustillos had a huge pharmacy, very famous, and José García Crespo, that we still have a soda in Mexico from García Crespo's company. It's near a mountain with a mineral water there, so source. So, well, some known characters there. And for example, Juan Calderón from the Escuela Nacional de Medicina, and José María Lazo de la Vega also. So what were the target diseases? Target diseases were from minor cuts. Many patents were to heal pimples, cuts, you know, everyday life things, but many more were for fevers. So there's still a very high attention in malaria, and many tonics and blood regeneratives, analgesia, gastrointestinals, of course. Syphilis is still very important to them. Respiratory, the disinfectants, some cosmetics. Lactogenic is another topic that was very common. And some veterinary patents, insecticides, and other uses. So at this point, we must say that the uses or the research line that were held in the National Medical Institute and the School of Medicine does not match completely with these interests. So we believe these were like almost common people. You know, I know a recipe from my grandmother that is really good at pimples, and I'm going to ask for a patent. So they went, and the patent was granted. Dosage forms still, as compared with the National Medical Institute, we do see some the use of not really new, but well, tablets were fairly new in the 19th century. But the use of tablets, for example, was not applied in the National Medical Institute. But here we do see tablets, and in fact, some innovations in tablets, as for example, some excipients to bind better to faces or to components, and in order to get a better compressed tablet. Some other innovations. I believe there's like more than 5 patents in effervescent magnesias, or also called aerated magnesia. Wafers, which was a very common pharmaceutical dose. Wafers having a better closing system, for example. A porous structure for substance retention, not only for pharmacy uses, but for other uses as well. Hypodermic injections, which we could expect that. And improvements in unctuous tablets. So these hypodermic injections and improvements in unctuous were also not found at the National Medical Institutes. So some of the new drug combinations, and I brought you an example. This is a combination for curing syphilis that the innovation consisted in mixing for the first time ever, as told us by the patent, potassium iodine, mercury, and local plant extracts such as sapsaparilla, guayacán, and some others. So that's an innovation in new drug combinations. But we also have new formulas. So, and this is also an example. And as you can see, we're still using many plants, you know, in the new active pharmaceutical ingredients. And here's a machine for massive production for sticking plasters. I like this very much. These cylinders were used to, of course, put the cloth there, and then the cylinders had to make some rounds. And if you see part number B, there's the place where you would put the unctuous or the ointment or whatever it was there. And so between A and B part, the plaster went very even. So this was like, instead of doing it yourself in your pharmacy, you can use this equipment, which will give you a massive production. And in the O recipient, you would put some ice so the plaster didn't move. So in the discussions patents, we found patents with very common therapeutic applications, such as purgatives, anti-malarian, antithermals, analgesics, tonics, and cardiotonics. Most of them were still in pharmacy confection. So the innovation resides either in their combinations or in the process. There are many patents in enhancing or improving processes. And as we've been telling, unlike the National Medical Institute and the School of Medicine, patents do not show specific interest in solving any public health concern, you know, like a national, really clear line. So the patents are about massive symptoms like pain. In the National Medical Institute, we would find, for example, a line of investigation in psychiatric disorders. And of course, they were trying Teposan and many other plants there, looking for some plants to treat them. And we also find in the National Medical Institute a lot of work in plants for etylic or narcotic abuse. There was, as you may know, in the first decade of the 20th century, it was among many countries a big concern about the abuse of narcotics. And in Mexico, the first law against this or to regulate this was issued in around the 1921. And so the National Medical Institute, you can see these actions with the scientists, but of course not in the patents of any people, normal people. So, of course, the institutions for pharmacy wanted to fulfill the work that had been done since since Spanish people arrived to America. And in the National Medical Institute, sections 3 and 4 did not manage to consolidate due to operative issues. So we were discouraged when we didn't find that there was incidence of the National Medical Institute in the patents, because the main purpose of the National Medical Institute was to innovate and to exploit Mexican plants and Mexican medical resources. So there is not sufficient evidence of innovation as in National Medical Institute. We must say, as you heard yesterday, that it was an impressive work into chemical analysis of plants, and it stayed in the National Pharmacology and other texts, so that were very important, but not with no or with little emphasis in patents in Mexico. I'm sorry, I was very fast at the beginning. Thank you very much.